Well, welcome everyone. Today's service is about music, the glory of music. And there are some exquisite pieces awaiting you. Really, really beautiful stuff. We open with Mack Wilberg's great setting of the hymn, When in Our Music God is Glorified. This hymn says it all, really. If you want to sing along with the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, open your chat. But here it is. Readings.
For the first reading from the second book of Chronicles, chapter 5, verses 13 and 14. When they lifted up their voices with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music and praised the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priests could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of God.
The second reading is by Pablo Casals, the noted Spanish cellist, composer, and conductor. For the past 80 years, I have started each day in the same manner. It is not a mechanical routine, but something essential to my daily life. I go to the piano and I play two preludes and fugues of Bach. I cannot think of doing otherwise. It is a sort of benediction on the house, but this is not its only meaning for me. It is rediscovery of the world of which I have the joy of being a part. It fills me with awareness of the wonder of life and with the feeling of the incredible marvel of being a human being.
And the third reading is a letter by Robert Shaw to the Collegiate Chorale on February 12, 1953. Someone asked me later Wednesday night what I had meant by saying music is the most moral of the arts. At least two things come to mind in justification of the instinct. The first is that the making of music is the everlasting and inescapable act of creation. With the visual arts, a work is completed. It may be viewed by people of succeeding generations, usually singly. But the life of music is reborn at every singing. It actually doesn't exist on paper, but in time and in sound. It has existed in the composer's spirit, but at each singing, it seeks a new life. And the performer, though his craft is that of representation and his proper approach that of humility, cannot escape the responsibilities of creation. And that has some moral references. The second thing that comes to mind is that of all the arts, music is the most linked with community of expression. This meaning of music is somehow most open to the amateur musician, and nowhere does it find its expression so fully as among people who sing together. It rests upon a common devotion to the composer's utterance and a mutual respect for the personal dignity of fellow workers. This ends the reading.
Piece of music gets me every time. Music is everywhere. It pours out of every imaginable digital device that we can find in the world. It follows us around stores, restaurants, and all sorts of other buildings and locations. Surrounds us in cars, boats, and airplanes. And sometimes excites us in concert halls, best of Broadway, movie theaters, and yes, even in churches. I'm here today to reflect on special times, these special moments when a piece of music offers us more than entertainment or diversion, when it inspires, spiritually refreshes, strikes us where we live, helps us remember or celebrate something important, or offers insight in a time of doubt, confusion, or even despair. I'm going to do this with a series of tableaus or scenes in time. And I ask you to let your imaginations fly. Just let them go. So our first tableau is a long, long, long time ago. Imagine that you are standing at the edge of an endless open plain. It's early in the morning, with still some dew on the ground, at a time when humanity first appeared. Next to you are four men apparently waiting at the edge of the plain to venture out on a hunting expedition, which happens several mornings a week. Three of them are veterans, veteran hunters. The fourth is a young recruit. All of them appear nervous because hunting trips can be dangerous and are always critical to the food supply. Out there are large animals and birds. The people in the caves nearby are depending on the success of these hunters. Each hunter carries a club and a bag. Soon they start out, and by late morning, they have come to a clump of trees, and they decide to stop and rest. The youngest hunter is on the far right, and out of the corner of his right eye, he spies something gleaming in the sun a few feet away. So he very tentatively, he edges over to the right, haltingly at first. What he sees is a long, thin bone, motionless, perhaps from a large bird, and the sun's rays treat the bone like a light. Soon he touches the bone, and then he picks it up, sees that it is hollow, and after fooling with it for a while, even to the point of trying to taste it, he accidentally blows at one end. A piercing, medium-pitched tone blares out, a sound that none of the hunters had ever heard. The young hunter drops the bone and jumps away, and then slowly picks it up again and tentatively blows again. These men had never heard a sound like this. It was a musical tone with evenly spaced overtones, not a disorganized noise. Humanity had discovered its first musical instrument.
I keep trying to unmute her. I just can't get it to come.
Marty, can you mute Nancy? Go ahead, Ralph.
Humanity had discovered its first musical instrument. Where did the strange sound come from? Musical sounds came to be regarded as coming from the sacred, the divine, the other, from other than humanity. Not surprisingly, it came to be used in worship services. And yes, over time, it also came to be used for entertainment. If you go into the caves of thousands of years ago, you see assemblies of people and they're playing instruments as well. But always, music was a mystery, a connection to the divine, and soon a structural element of the world itself. So now we're going to move ahead thousands of years, and we're at the time in Greece of Plato and Aristotle. Plato said this about music. Music gives soul to the universe, wings to the mind, flight to the imagination, and charm and gaiety to life. Now think about that. That's pretty potent. Soul, wings, flight, real charm. And what are they covering? They're covering universe. the mind, the imagination, and life itself. Plato's pupil, Aristotle, goes further. The planets and stars are set upon concentric crystalline spheres which rotate around the earth, arranged in ratios to each other. Each sphere produces a musical tone, and the revolution of the various spheres in concert produces harmony and melody. The music of the spheres vibrate through the world, and when men make earthly music to accompany this music of the heavens, they participate in the harmony of the universe. Wow. That is giving music a lot of power. We're talking about the physics of what makes the world work, what makes the world go round. It's clear that the structural power of music has been formulating in the human mind for a long time, but Plato and Aristotle supplied the logic and the eloquence. From antiquity through the Middle Ages, through the Renaissance, into later times, variations of music of the spheres appear in writings of some of the most famous writers of their time, describing the role of music at its highest level, the music of the spheres. And that's why we saw the earth in the lead-in to this tableau. Now I'm going to go to the second tableau, and we're going to skip ahead to the 13th century, to a 13th century cathedral church that is celebrating the feast of Corpus Christi. Corpus Christi in Latin means body of Christ. In 1264, Pope Urban IV instituted the Feast of Corpus Christi as an additional special celebration of the Eucharist outside of Lenten Holy Week. Now, for centuries already, Christians had been celebrating the establishment of the Eucharist on Holy Thursday, Maundy Thursday, and again remembering it at the end of the Good Friday service. The Pope wanted to have another commemoration of the institution of the Eucharist outside of Lent and Holy Week. These are, after all, penitential times. He wanted it out in the open where it's a more joyful time. So he commissioned the foremost theologian of the Middle Ages, Thomas Aquinas, to compose the unique texts for that celebration. Aquinas delivered big time, an amazing set of prayers, processional hymns, and other prayers. They included four iconic hymns. Among them is Pange Lingua, one of the all-time great hymns, and it is a chant hymn. We don't know the composer of this tune, but this hymn, melody and text, is surely one of the most sublime spiritual statements of all time. It was sung during the procession from the main altar at the end of the Mass to the side altar, where there would be a celebration just for the Eucharist itself. The English translation at the beginning says it all. Sing, my tongue, the Savior's glory, of his flesh, the mystery, sing, of the blood, all price exceeding, shed by our immortal King. What you're going to hear now are the first verse and the last two verses of this fabulous hymn. Every time I hear that, and many times, of course, it has been in the services, because it's also now used during Holy Week on Maundy Thursday and on Good Friday, and of course for the Feast of Corpus Christi. Every time I hear that chant, it really gets to me, and it speaks volumes about what this whole celebration is about. The amazing Christian chant repertoire evolved over 1,000 years from the blending of the Jewish liturgical chants at the time of Jesus, along with the interaction with local folk music, and over 1,000 years, an incredibly rich chant repertoire developed. This chant repertoire not only embellished thousands of years of beautiful services in churches and chapels, it also led to the evolution of sacred and secular choral music, which we began to see in the late Middle Ages, through the Renaissance, and all the way through to our own time. Literally, the development of that kind of music evolved out of chant. So it's not just fabulous to listen to, it really has led to so much more. I'm going to go now, we're going to leap ahead again, this time to December 5th, 1837, in Paris. Now, music can be incredibly quiet and intimate, and at other times it can be very large and very dramatic. The 18th and 19th century saw the evolution of large forms, oratorios. I mean, you think about the Bach B minor Mass, when you think of those great Handel oratorios. And then it kept getting bigger. Think about the big masses, the Missa Solemnis, for example, by Beethoven, the Brahms Requiem, all of these great large pieces of music that could last well past an hour and involve huge choruses. Among the most flamboyant are some of the compositions of the French composer Hector Berlioz. Now, he was asked in 1835 to Latin Requiem text and created a stunning piece of music. I want to mention a personal note here, and that is that in July 1980, at St. Mary's Cathedral in San Francisco, we hosted Robert Shaw in what was called a Festival of Masses. We had a chorus of 240, and each weekend during the two-week festival, Shaw would conduct the festival chorus in a major, huge work. The first weekend was Berlioz Requiem, the second was the Verdi. So during the Berlioz Requiem, there is the most explosive text, the Dies Irae, which I don't have to go into the translation. Everybody knows that that is a pretty grim judgment-based text. But in the middle of that is a moment when the orchestra, and I'm talking now about brass, percussion, and singers, reach a pitch, a huge pitch. The text is a trumpet spreading a wondrous sound through the sepulchres of all lands will drive all mankind before the throne. I don't know of any other moment that's quite like this. And I can tell you, we put the timpani, the drums, we moved the Archbishop's chair out where it is because it's located in the dead center of the cathedral and acoustically the richest place. And we put all the timpani there. And I can tell you that night there was a happening. It was just stunning. This is an example of large form music where your aesthetic is large and intense and dramatic. And this is quite extraordinary. So what we're going to listen to is a performance by Robert Shaw conducting the Atlanta Symphony And this is the little tuba mirum section of the Dies Irae. You're in for a treat. Ahead again. Now we're going to go to September 1997. And another personal note. It was in early September 1997. It was a particularly warm night. And around 3:30 in the morning, I went to my family room to flip on the TV because I couldn't sleep. And when I did, and flipped, as we used to say, the channels, I came upon a cathedral church. It was clearly a cathedral. The ministers and the altar boys were wearing purple or violet colored chasubles, which of course tipped it off that this was an Episcopal church. And when I got there, the boys choir was singing. It was quite beautiful. And then there were prayers. And I realized that I had stumbled into the funeral service for Diana Spencer. Soon after that, a gentleman with blonde hair came out and sat down at a grand piano and played something that, when we talk about special musical moments, this is one of the greatest. The song was Candle in the Wind, the singer Elton John. And I can't say anymore. All you can do is look and listen. This still affects me today. Here is Candle in the Wind.
Now in the nave, Elton John sings Candle in the Wind with new words specially written a few days ago by Bernie Taupin.
Goodbye, England's rose. May you ever grow in our hearts. You were the grace that placed yourselves where lives were torn apart. You called out to our country and you whispered to those in pain. Now you belong to heaven and the stars spell out your name. And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. And Your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will. Loveliness, we've lost those empty days without your smile. This torch we'll always carry for our nation's golden child. Even though we try, the truth brings us to tears. All our words cannot express the joy you've brought us through the years. And it seems to me you've lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. And your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will. Goodbye, England's rose. May you ever grow in our hearts. You were the grace that placed yourselves where lives were torn apart. Goodbye, English rose, from a country lost without your soul. Who missed the wings of your compassion more than you will ever know. And it seems to me you've lived your life like a candle in the wind, never fading with the sunset when the rain set in. Your footsteps will always fall here along England's greenest hills. Your candles burned out long before your legend ever will.
The 20th century, particularly. Around the world, but very much in the United States, saw an outpouring of popular song. Songs by and of themselves that would play on the radio, and then songs that come from shows, from films. It's been an extraordinary time, and that continues into the 21st century. There are many examples of individual songs that have meant a great deal. I do a lot of weddings, and these days everyone wants their own, the music that means uniquely to them. And so I've gotten a really good look at, over the last X number of decades, really, what songs mean a lot to different people. But these songs mean a great deal. And this, of course, is an example of a song that means much to a lot of people indeed. The last tableau is a celebration of choral music all through the 20th century and easily into our time of the 21st century. We are living in an era of stunning new choral pieces that are coming out virtually every day. As someone who looks at a lot of choral music, I can tell you that doing this, and I easily look at least 100 pieces a year, doing this is so much more fun than it was 30 or 40 years ago. There is so much, there are so many fine composers and arrangers all over the world. Probably the two most celebrated composers of our time In this country, it's Morton Lauritsen, who is at the University of Southern California. His piece, Omagni Mysterium, has been voted by choral directors the world over for at least the last 10 years as the most beautiful choral piece in the world. And certainly in England, there is no one that quite compares to John Rutter. Frankly, John Rutter everywhere. The sheer volume of gorgeous and meaningful, perceptive choral pieces that have rolled from this guy are just unbelievable. So I'm going to end this final tableau with one of his pieces. This one, given the world we're living in, given the huge issue of climate change of our time, given all of that, it seemed to me that maybe the most appropriate Rutter piece to play right now would be his For the Beauty of the Earth. Not only the piece, and this is a performance from the Mormon Tabernacle. Not only the piece, but also the video that was put together to go with the piece. So here is John Rutter's exquisite as a celebration and a sample of the great choral music of our time. Here is For the Beauty of the Earth.
Thank you.
Quite lovely. That was Mack Wilberg conducting the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. Mack, of course, is a great choral arranger and composer in his own right. We heard his setting of the opening hymn earlier, and our choir at Sausalito Presbyterian is blessed to be able to do a number of Mack's arrangements, as well as many of John Rutter's pieces, but he's an extraordinary musician. So we are living in a glorious time of choral music, and the world has come a very long way from first discovering that musical tone on the ground so many thousands of years ago. And music has come so far, and it's meant so much to so many people at different times. The special moments for people of various pieces of music is endless. But the important point that I wanted to make today is that for all the music that's everywhere, I mean, frankly, we're surrounded by music wallpaper. It's everywhere. But there's more there than that. And it's the more there than that that's so very, very exciting. Now, I can't conclude this without talking about the unique and difficult situation that we find ourselves in right now. Because of COVID-19, we suddenly discover the necessity for virtual music making. What makes it even worse is that COVID-19 appears to be spread by one of its major methods of spreading, perhaps it's only, the spreading of droplets that come out of human beings, large and small, that come out of our mouths when we speak, even more excitingly when we cough, and tragically, also when we sing. Singing propels these droplets in a stunning way. I've looked at a few scientific videos, and at first it's difficult to look, because that means that we have some major technological work to do to get past this to the point where we can have choral groups back in church, when we can have church services, when we can allow our people to sing hymns, people close together, and also choirs to sing without spreading the virus. So there is a lot of work to be done. Meanwhile, the human race is constantly looking for workarounds. We all have them. And so we see the rise of virtual choirs. Now the technique is simple. Let's say that you want 100 singers to sing something. You have each singer, first of all, you create a bass piece, an accompaniment to which everyone else can sing. You then have 100 singers record their voices exactly to that bass piece that has been created. Then you take those 101 sound files, and through the wizardry of video and audio editing, you layer them and you create virtual choirs that look like, at this moment, even though each person is in a different location, they are singing together. At any rate, the bottom line is we now have the rise of virtual choirs. And a number of people have been working on them. We're working on the same thing here for our church. During the benediction at the end of the service, we're going to play one of these virtual pieces that was put together. A setting of John Rutter, John Rutter's The Lord Bless You and Keep You, which is a great benediction piece. So you'll get a chance to see a group of madrigal singers who put this together, and you'd swear that they were singing it right now, all together, and even though they're spread out around the world or around the country, it's as if they're in the same room. And this is a virtual piece, so we're going to enjoy this. But people are doing this work, and some rather extraordinary things have come about because of it. In any event, that brings us really today and to the extraordinary cavalcade of music from antiquity to our time. And I hope that that in going through these brief moments or snapshots in time, these tableaus, that we've had a chance to look at a few special moments and what they meant to everyone. Now, it's time for our dialogue. I can see that I've run the clock pretty far. So this will be a short dialogue session. Anyone who wants to share any thoughts or comments, unmute yourself and just start talking.
I want to thank you, Ralph, for the incredible journey. Education, you always are a master at teaching us, but the joy of music to me is God. Nature and music are God. You brought it full circle with your journey of the different things. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
You're more than welcome. You're more than welcome. Anyone else? Just unmute and start talking.
I just want to say I really miss being with our choir. I really, really miss that. Thank you.
Thank you. I do too. We are getting together online and doing things, but we definitely, when we performed our last time, March the 8th, little did we know that it would be a long time before we would be back in church singing. But we enjoy doing it, and those pieces are,
heaven on earth.
Also, thank you so much for your collection of pieces, what you bring to us and allow us to stretch ourselves to explore and sing. It's really a joy to have to strive to, like Jen said, really represent what those composers, what those arrangers were trying to get through. And that responsibility that we have as musicians, as people who love music, as humans, you allow us to really have to put both feet in and get in there. So thanks so much.
Thank you. We'll have one more if anyone else, and then go into prayer if anyone else wants to say anything.
Louise, then Beverly.
Louise?
No? Beverly?
Oh, I just loved it all. It was wonderful. I feel like it was a journey through history that some of it I knew, much of it I did not. And, I'm so pleased to know that, or to hear that music today is so incredibly important and that we are so inspired by that. We think of things as in our past as history as being the best, but I'm so pleased that you made us aware of how much current
these are
music
great.
These
are, yeah, these are, there are so many things you can look back on and say, boy, the good old days, but they were so great than that. But let me tell you this, in the choral music world, there is just, it's wonderful. And there's so many groups around the world, in this country and around the world, who are doing really wonderful work. I'm going to offer a brief prayer. And then, even though you are all on mute, and please be on mute, we will together say the Lord's Prayer together. Dear Lord, we thank you for the life you have given us. We thank you for our dear loved ones, family, and friends, the life we share with each other, our safety, security, and well-being, and the safety, security, and well-being of all your children and our brothers and sisters the world over. We thank you for the beauty of the earth and the universe, for the noble strivings of all people everywhere for a better world and for a greater future. We ask for the insight, courage, and fortitude to overcome the coronavirus as expeditiously as possible, and make our country and the world more healthful and secure. We ask you to shower your blessings and love on all heroic doctors, nurses, and other healthcare providers who risk their lives around the clock to save other lives. Bless all other essential workers who likewise risk their lives for others. This pandemic has also brought immense economic hardship to millions, again, around the world. Please shower your blessings and love on these, your children, and guide the restoration and strengthening of their security. We also ask that you enlighten and ennoble leaders around the world to enable all people to achieve and celebrate their full potential and create a new world of peace, prosperity, and justice for all. Amen. And now, together, our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
We're not going to play the Givelify animation today, but please remember that as you can, make an offering to the church, to Sausalito Pres. It enables us to do all the things that we do. And I have to say, right now, we're involved in a great deal of feeding the hungry, literally, in the Sausalito community. It's very heartwarming and amazing what's going on there. And I can't say enough for what Paul is doing and all, so many people in our congregation. So please remember them. And now we come to the benediction. As we move into a new week, let us celebrate each other, our family, friends, and loved ones. Let us live our lives to the fullest, helping others whenever and wherever we can. And let us continue to make our fullest contribution to the overcoming of the coronavirus in all of its manifestations. We conclude the benediction with the Batavia Madrigal Singers giving a virtual performance of John Rutter's "The Lord Bless You and Keep You."
Shine upon you and shine upon you and
for our weekly fellowship together. Thank you again.
Robin, will you host me, please?
Done.
Thank you very much.
Wonderful job, Ralph.
Your host, Marty.
Yes, I got it. Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
Ralph.
Thank you, Ralph.
Love the music.
It was wonderful, Ralph. Thank you. And Robin, nice job.
Hey, listen, I would be totally host and on a barren rock if it weren't for Robin. Robin, we spent a good part of this week with each other and going through things, but she is definitely the new Wizard of Oz.
Guru.
Enjoy your fellowship time, everyone. Thank you, Robin and Ralph.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.